Blessed be the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. Come on, somebody lift him up. Hallelujah. That is why we're here today. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Is that why we're here today? Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Let's give him some glory right now. Come on, we don't need a beat. We don't need a tune. With everything inside of me, Lord. With everything inside of me, God. I want to give you praise. I want to give you glory and honor because of who you are. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. How many of you know that the earth is groaning? How many of you feel that the earth and nature, hallelujah, is rumbling? Just spent 10 days in California, and there's all kinds of earthquakes. They're having them all the time. They're not even in the news because they're so common. Hallelujah. There's something about the earth that's moaning and groaning, hallelujah, for that time, hallelujah. And even so now, Paul said it's now, hallelujah, hallelujah. For we know that the whole creation groaneth and travaileth in pain together until now, he says. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Can I tell you the kingdom of heaven is at hand? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The kingdom of heaven is at hand. Yeah, I know, Brother Corin. Heard that for years. Amen. Bobby Connor says, just not too long ago, he said, I feel that the church has become so familiar with a God that they don't even know. Somebody hear me today. Don't you dare get familiar in the presence of an almighty God. When I stand here and I have chills coming up and down my spine when I talk about the kingdom. Hallelujah. And when I blow that trumpet, a sound that I'm listening for every day, I'm beginning to wake up in the morning with a spirit of anticipation. What are you doing? What are you doing? Where are you? Oh, my shalala mokura kia shata. My God, there is a place. There is a place. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Where we ultimately become that mature man and we usher in the kingdom of heaven. I believe it. I believe it more than ever. Don't let it sound mundane. Don't get so familiar with it that you forget the significance of what you are in the middle of that kingdom. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, Jesus, Jesus. Come on, we. Oh, hallelujah, church. Let's lift him up. Let's lift him up. Yes. Yes. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Come on, say something inside of you well up today. Play it again. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Here it is. What does it mean to be saved? Is it more than just a prayer to pray? More than just a way to heaven? What does it mean to be His? To be formed in His likeness? Know that we have a purpose. Do you have a purpose? To be salt and light in the world, in the world. To be salt and light. Sing it again.
to be salt and light in the world, in the world, to be salt and light in the world. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Say so, say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Say so, say so.
Here it is. Oh, that the church would arise. Oh, that we could see through His eyes. We could show the world heaven. Show what it means to be His, to be formed in His likeness. Show them we have a purpose. To be salt and light in the world, in the world. To be salt and light in the world. To be salt and light in the world, in the world. To be salt and light in the world.
Oh, let the redeemed of the Lord rise up. Let the redeemed of the Lord rise up. Let the redeemed of the Lord rise up. Rise up, rise up. Let the redeemed of the Lord rise up. Let the redeemed of the Lord rise up. Let the redeemed of the Lord rise up, rise up, rise up.
Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Say so, say so. Oh, yo. Oh, that the church would arise. Oh, that we could see with His eyes, you could show the world heaven. Show what it means to be His, to be formed in His likeness. We have a purpose, oh yes.
To be salt and light in the world, in the world. To be salt and light in the world. To be salt and light in the world, in the world. To be salt and light in the world.
Oh, let the redeemed of the Lord rise up.
Let the redeemed of the Lord rise up.
Let the redeemed of the Lord rise up.
Oh, yes.
Let the redeemed of the Lord rise up.
Let the redeemed of the Lord rise up.
Let the redeemed of the Lord rise up.
Oh, yes. Hallelujah.
I am redeemed. I am redeemed.
I am redeemed.
Do you really believe it? Oh, do you believe it? Come on, somebody say yes.
Oh, I am redeemed.
Oh,
I am redeemed. I am redeemed. I am redeemed.
Come on, keep saying it till you believe it.
Oh, I am redeemed.
I am redeemed.
Lord, I'm redeemed.
I am redeemed.
Hallelujah.
Oh, yeah.
Sing it again one more time now.
Oh, I am redeemed. I am redeemed.
Oh, I am redeemed.
I am redeemed.
I believe it.
I am redeemed.
I believe it.
I am redeemed. Oh,
let the redeemed of the Lord say so.
Let the redeemed of the Lord say so.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
Let the redeemed of the Lord say so.
My God. Say so. Say so. Sing it again now.
Let the redeemed of the Lord say so.
Oh, let the redeemed of the Lord say so.
Let the redeemed of the Lord say so.
Say so. Say so. Hararamos sandakia. Uramos shakia. My God. Somebody needs to say it until you believe it. Come on. Hallelujah. 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 Some folks in the church need a baptism of joy. Amen. Hallelujah. You know, the scripture talks about that we need to dance for joy. A lot of you are waiting for the Lord just to knock you over the head and jerk you around a little bit. And when really, when you get to worshiping and you get a little pep in your feet, don't hold that back. Don't quench your spirit. Come on, just let the Lord have his way. Because when you do, you open up avenues for you and I to begin to believe what we say. Sometimes you have to just keep saying it until you see it happen. Hallelujah. Every one of us are human. Every one of us go through struggles and trials. We spoke last night about dry places. Oh my goodness. We began to revelate after the conversation and just so much things, so much truths in the Word of God. Hallelujah. About dry places and what they are and what they are not. Oh, hallelujah. But the scripture says in John 7 that out of your bellies shall flow rivers of living water. My prayer this morning was, Lord, I want the river. I want the river. I want the flow. I want the flow. Oh, my God. So that when I walk out these doors, I don't want it for me. I've already got it, man. I've got the joy. But when I walk outside these doors, I want it to change lives. Oh, I want it to change lives. Sing it with us. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Yes. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. Oh, there is power in the name of Jesus. Hear it. To break every chain. Break every chain. Break every chain. Sing it again. Oh, break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. Oh, to break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. Break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. All sufficient sacrifice, so freely given, such a price. Brought redemption. Do you believe it? Heaven gates swing wide. Oh, sing it again. Sing the verse. All sufficient sacrifice. You don't have to do anything else. Oh, freely given. Hallelujah.
Heaven's gates
swing wide. Now do two. Oh, there's an army rising up. Anybody want to be a part of the army of God? There's an army rising up. There's an army rising up. lifting up to break every chain, 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 break every chain. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. Break every chain, break every chain, break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. Come on, come on, sing it with me now. I hear those chains falling. Oh, yes. I hear those chains falling. Oh, I hear those chains falling. Break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. Break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. I hear those chains falling. I hear those chains falling. Can you hear them falling right now? I hear those chains falling. Break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. Now while she plays it, just be quiet for a minute. Sometimes you can't hear them because you're not listening. You're not tuned to the Asata Mokura, the things of the Spirit. My God. Come on, somebody tune into the things of God. There's some chains in your life that is breaking. God wants to break it permanently. And you're not even listening. You're not even listening. You're going through the motions. You're saying you hear them. You're singing the song and it sounds beautiful. But oh God, you're doing it with your lips, but your heart is far from Him. Thus saith the Lord. Thus saith the Lord. Listen. Listen. Oh yeah. Play it, sis. My God. Oh God. God, I hear some chains of pride falling right now. I hear some chains of pride falling right now. Some of you are so about yourself, God cannot even speak to you. God, in the name of Jesus, break me. Break me, oh God. I must decrease. I need to disappear in what I am and who I am so that God can increase. Created me a clean heart, O Lord, and renew a right spirit in me. Oh, that I would know your word and your voice and proclaim it in the darkness. Some of you showed up this morning going through the motions, wanting your face to be seen. And you don't even know that God is working in the background of your life, trying to woo you into His presence. But you're so concerned about what people think that you can't break within yourself. My God. Oh, I feel this so strong. Come on, church, just stay with me a minute. Stay with me a minute. What? Can you not pray 1 hour with me? His closest three couldn't even hang in the garden. What's he going to say to you? What's he going to say to you? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh God. Oh, all sufficient sacrifice. Everything you need, he's already given. Freely given. Such a price. But our redemption, heaven's gates swing wide. Oh, yes, it does. Sing, there is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus.
Break every chain.
Oh, break every chain. 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 Oh, break every chain. Break every chain. Break every chain. Somebody needs to let the chains break. Hallelujah. Break every chain. Break every chain. Oh, break every chain. Break every chain. Break every chain. Come on, listen. Listen. I hear those chains falling. You hear them falling? Yes. Oh, I hear those chains falling. I hear those chains falling. Break every chain. 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 Yes, yes, yes. Oh, my God. My ear is attuned to the things of the Spirit. Come on, church. Come on, church. Put your ear to the heart of God. See what He is saying. See what He's saying. See where He wants to take you. If you're new here and you're new to this, God cares just as much about you as He does me. Scripture tells me that He has no respect of persons. In other words, He doesn't put you over me or me over you or any other ministry that you can think of. Hallelujah. We're on a level plane when it comes standing before the Lord. But the thing that makes a difference in the voice and in the mind of God, Scripture says He has no respect of person, but He does respect your sacrifice. Abel brought a good one before the Lord. according to the word of the Lord. Cain brought one. It was a good sacrifice. It's fine. But it wasn't what the Lord required. It wasn't what the Lord required. Can I tell you, under the anointing of the Holy Ghost right now, God is requiring things of you that He has never required before. These things are not the difference between salvation and not. These things are the difference between, are you going to successfully walk in your purpose and meaning that He has called you into? Oh God. Oh God. The name of the Lord, Yahweh. Yahweh. Cry out to the Lord today, church. My provider, hey, Yahweh, with everything that is in me, Lord. Oh, I'll say yes to your will and yes to your ways. Speak your word. Oh, Jehovah Nisi. Oh, with everything in me, God. You are omnipresent, God. You are omnipowerful, Lord.
Yahweh.
You are everything I need. Everything I need, Lord.
Yahweh,
you're my provider.
Yahweh.
You're my healer, Lord. Oh,
Yahweh,
yes.
Yahweh.
You reign on high. Oh, you're my God. Oh, yes, you're my salvation. You're my soon coming King, Lord.
Yahweh,
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 with everything that is in me, Lord. I want to say yes to your will, Lord.
Yahweh,
I want to walk in your statutes. I want to walk in your presence, Lord.
Yahweh, Yahweh.
I want to seek your face instead of your hands, Lord.
Yahweh, Yahweh.
I want to get to know you, Lord, and not so much about what I can receive. Oh, I want a relationship with you, oh Lord.
Yahweh,
oh God. Somebody needs to say yes to you, Lord. Yes. Yes to your will and yes to your way.
Deserve my worship.
Yes.
Oh, deserve, yeah. we lift you high.
Oh, yes.
Yahweh.
Oh, Yahweh.
Adonai. Yahweh. Yahweh.
Lord, with everything
Yahweh,
that is in me, Lord.
Yahweh,
sweep through your presence,
you
Lord Jesus. Sweep through your presence,
Yahweh,
Lord.
Yahweh,
because it's about you, O Lord.
Yeshua Mashiach, Yahweh.
Yahweh.
Yeshua Mashiach, Yahweh.
Yes, Lord.
Yahweh,
Yahweh. Yahweh.
Oh,
Yahweh, Yahweh. Yahweh. Oh, you are my God and you reign on high. There's nothing that was created less than was created by your hands. Why should I worry? Why should I fret when I'm walking in the paths of righteousness for the sake of Almighty God? Why should I fret? Why should I fear when I'm walking in the light that you have given me? My God, oh, oh, oh,
you Yahweh.
Oh, yes.
The only one we need.
Ah,
you are Elohim.
Mm,
the only one we need.
Yes, Lord.
You are Elohim. Mm, the only one we need. Yahweh.
Yahweh, Yahweh,
you are Adonai.
Oh, Yahweh,
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 we lift you on high. Yahweh,
Yahweh, oh yes. Oh, yes.
Yahweh,
my God.
Yahweh,
there's a holy presence in this place. I want to challenge you, whoever you are, wherever you are in this building, take just a few moments of reverence. Of reverence. Did you know honor is a currency? Just like you take money down to the bank or down to the restaurant. Honor is a currency in the kingdom of heaven. And right now, holy God, I want every soul in this building just to begin to honor you. A spirit of honor. A spirit of reverence. Going to go on in this service, but there is a holy reverence. Don't laugh it off. Don't push it out of your life. When Brother Tucker comes, this isn't a different This isn't a different part of a service. This is a continuation of what God is doing.
Well, praise the Lord. What a beautiful presence of God in this place. Amen. Amen. There is no place I'd rather be. You can get what you need here today. Who believes prayer is a time where you can be equipped with the things needed that you're going through? Prayer is important. Prayer doesn't just get you closer to God, but it gets you to a place where God can equip you with what you need. I had a wonderful experience with God at work this week. I was getting ready to go up on a scaffolding about 30 feet high. And it was in an area that there's two massive, I couldn't even tell you how big these tanks were, but they're about 30 feet tall. They're together. There's only about 2 foot of room to squeeze by these things. And then there's a wall back there, and it's pitch black. It's in an industrial building. It's pitch black back there. There's a six-inch pipe, carbon steel pipe running through. So you're going through it like this. You're tight like this. And before I got up there, I grabbed the tools that I thought I needed to get the job done. So I grabbed those tools I thought I needed. I got up there. I'm squeezing through, trying to get by. I get back there, and I find out real quick that I do not have the tool that I needed to get the job done. So I grabbed a tool that I thought would work anyway. It wasn't designed for the purpose. And I started trying to use that, and I found out very quickly that tool that I was using that was not for design for that job was actually making it a lot harder. And the Lord began to speak to me, and he said, that's most Christianity today. That's most people today. They're trying to succeed in a purpose that God ordained with a tool he didn't. Let me say it like this. When God appeared to Moses and he said to Moses, Moses, what's that in your right hand? He said, a rod, Lord. He said, throw it on the ground. So Moses threw it on the ground. It turned into a snake and he said, pick it back up. He picked it back up. He said, use that rod as a sign. That's the purpose of it. It's going to help you out, Moses. You imagine what Moses would have said, no, Lord, I don't like the rod too much. I think I'm going to take something else. I like this rock over here. What about David? If David would have chosen to pick up a sword instead of a sling, God allowed David to go through some things so he could learn to practice on that sling. That was the tool that God had given him. He used it to kill lions and bears and wolves to protect the sheep. But you imagine what would have happened if David says, you know what? I've had a lot of practice on this sling. I know how to use it. But you know what? I think I'm going to pick up the sword now and try that out. David would have died on that battlefield. 100%. Why? Because he was trying to go face something with a tool that was not intended for it. What am I saying? We use tool. The best way to get a tool from that for the battle is to pray. See, you can't use the same tool you used last week because its purpose is not for the one you're going through now. See, anytime you go through something new, you can't try to use the tool from last week to try to defeat it this week. It's not how it works. God's always changing the tool because your circumstance is always changing. You've got to adapt to what you're going through. And that's what God comes in. He gives you the tools needed to overcome anything. Whether it's whether you've got to overcome an obstacle, whether you're dealing with some sort of sickness, disease, or cancer, God's got the tools. But quit picking up the wrong one. You know, I want to go. You can't You can't, and I realized real quick, I can't use a tool that its purpose wasn't made for. You ever try to hammer a nail with a wrench? It don't work very well. You ever try to tighten a bolt with a hammer? It don't work very well. You can't use a tool which purpose wasn't intended for it to try to succeed. You're not going to. It won't work. I said it like this on Facebook. It's hard to hammer a nail with a Q-tip and really hard and painful to clean your ears with a hammer. It don't work. This is an opportunity. I love what Pastor Corn said. This is an opportunity. It's a continuation. You did some worship. You did some praising. We exalted the name of the Father in this place. You brought a sacrifice. Now's the opportunity to go before the Lord and says, Lord, there's a tool I need. I don't know what it is yet, but you do. You know my circumstance. You know what I'm going through. This is your opportunity to go before the Lord and say, Lord, I need equipped for what you're putting me through, what I'm going through. See, God's got a tool ordained for the thing that you're going through. And a lot of the things that you go through is so God can see how you're going to act and how you're going to adapt and overcome it. It's how God is. We're supposed to be made like him. We're made in his image, yes. But the spiritual side, we got to be made in his image. How he went through everything was a guideline, the perfect guideline on how we act in things. So let's stand before the Lord today. We're going to go before the Lord in prayer. And if you're going through something, let's pray for the tool. Let's pray for the right tool that God will send it to you and that you will overcome. And it will make your journey easier. If you're using the wrong tool spiritually, it's going to be a hard one. You're going to kick, scream, and it's just not going to be a fun time for you. Amen. So let's go before the Lord in prayer. Who has a need by the uplifting of the hand? Yeah, we all have got needs. Amen. Amen. But what makes God so amazing is he already knows them. He already knows them. He knew them in eternity before you were ever born. He knew your name before you were ever born. He knew everything you were going to need through your entire life before you were born. But what God wants most is you to call out his name and say, Lord, I need you. I can't do it on my own. I don't have the tools necessary. I can't produce the tool, but Lord, you can. Anything that I need, amen. So Father, Lord, we just thank you for all that you do for us and bless us with, Lord. You are mighty God, the everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace, and the great I Am. I could do nothing but by you, Father. I can't even breathe unless you breathe into me, Father. And I thank you, Jesus, that you love me so much, Father. And you love every single person, Lord, in this place, Father. And Lord, every person who is going through any circumstance, any battle, Lord, I pray that you would equip them with the tools needed, Lord. Lord, to overcome, to win by you and through you. We are more than conquerors, Father. We are made sons and daughters by the adoption. We have an inheritance through you, Father. And I pray the inheritance into the earth, Father. I pray the kingdom, Lord, into this earth, Lord. Lord, whatever we bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. Whatever we loose, Lord, and I pray, Lord, that every stronghold shall be bound up, destroyed, Father. Every attack of the enemy shall be bound up and destroyed, Lord. And I pray the releasing of joy, peace, Lord, calmness. Lord, I pray for the releasing, Father, of healing in this place for every sickness, Father. I send the healing, Lord, anyone watching on live stream, Father, who is facing a sickness, Lord, who is facing anything, Lord, I pray it through the system. As you sent the word to the centurion servant, Lord, I send the word through the cables, Lord, through the television, Lord, through the computer, I send the word. Lord, we thank you for the power that you share with us. It is only by your name we can do nothing but by you. And Father, I pray that you would grow everyone in this place, everyone watching on live stream, in callings, giftings, and anointings, Lord. The world is getting darker. Lord, as the other Pastor Corin said, the earth is groaning and moaning, waiting for the manifestations of the sons of God. And Lord, we pray that you would reveal, Lord, in the earth, Lord, the sons and daughters of God. Send us out, Lord. Send us out that we may be manifested to heal the sick, Lord, to open blind eyes, Lord, to give food to the hungry, Father. Lord, let us live up to the name above all names. We are sons and daughters. We must reflect our Father. I thank you, Jesus. Never let us get cold, Lord. The world's getting darker. Lord, let us not be as the foolish virgins, Lord. But I pray, Lord, that you would pour out new oil daily that will fill it up, Lord. Fill up our lanterns, Lord. Let us trim the wicks, Father. The priest was to trim the wicks, Father. Trim anything that does not belong in our lives. Trim it, Lord. Cut it back so we can burn brighter. Lord, let us shine bright in a decaying world. Lord, let people grab onto our garments, say, you know Jesus, take us to him. Lord, let us not be idle servants in these last days, caring only for ourselves, caring only for what we receive. But Lord, I've received such an abundance, I want to share it with everyone. Let us shout it at the mountaintops, Father, in the street corners, Lord, at our jobs, Father. Lord, let us not fear, Lord, what others will think. We are living in the last days. Beware when you say the Lord delayeth, for he'll come as a thief in the night. Don't be unprepared. Examine ourselves. Examine yourselves and find that if there be anything in you that don't belong, pray that the God above all will remove it and replace it with something of him. Lord, if there is any of us in this place, Father, who is missing something in our lives and we're trying to find it through evil means or means that are not fulfilling, Father, I pray that you would remove it, Father, and place in us a puzzle piece of you, Father. Lord, I don't want to be an idle servant, but Lord, what you give me, let me increase it. Let me not bury and hide it away. Lord, we need you more and more now than ever. I want to share something with you real quick, everyone, and then I'm going to step back. But, you know, we've been praying for a long time, and the Lord recently showed me this. We've been praying for a long time. Church growth, church growth, church growth, church growth. We need more growth. We need more growth. I'm here to say the sad thing is, as the world gets darker, that's going to be a lot harder. You ever heard of the great falling away? There are going to be people who are going to leave. People you never thought would leave the church to go their own way, follow the ways of the earth, the things of man. You don't believe me? Look how many people followed Jesus, and right before he had to leave, how many were left? How many were left? 3,000 people plus followed Jesus. They came for the food, the blessing. They disappeared after that. A few followed him after that. But the same thing's going to happen again. Church growth from 40 years ago has dropped 40%. Why? I don't think anything different's being preached in the church. In some churches, absolutely, yes, there is. I'm not going to say there's no churches perfect. But you understand how many warnings we can give people. People are still going to obey the lust of the flesh, the pride of life, and all these things. I just want to be the one praying for them. Lord, whatever I can do to win them. You know, the Bible says persuade people by any means. Get them in. Try. Do something. You know, but Jesus said, I pray for the ones that we have, the ones that you gave me, Lord. I can't keep them all. This is Jesus talking. I can't keep them all. But what you've given me, I pray for them. We can't keep them all. But I pray for everyone in this place. That you would stay. That you would seek the Lord wholeheartedly. That if you've got a situation, a problem, the Bible says, bear up each other's infirmities. We're here for you. Let us bear your infirmities with you. Don't go through the struggle alone. You've got a God that loves you. We got several people in this church who I know love you. Would drop everything they're doing wherever you're at. You know, in these last days, I know I'm taking a while, but we've got to understand things. As these last days are approaching, we should not be separating from each other, strifing, bickering. I'm not saying we are. I'm not saying that. I'm giving you an idea. But we should be coming together in unity. As we see the day approaching, we should gather more, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves, which is the manner of some. But anytime we have church, anytime we have an opportunity to pray, we need to. Because I guarantee that there is going to come a time where you're going to be tried for praying. You're going to be set before the judges for your faith. If you don't believe that's going to happen, I'm sorry. You haven't read the word. There will be some that will absolutely have to answer for their faith. And the more you stay prayed up, the more you read your word, the more time you listen to the voice of the Father, He's going to help you through it all. He's going to strengthen you. You know, there's a scripture in the Bible which says, don't fear when they put you to judges, because in that hour, think not what to say, but through the Holy Ghost, I will give you the words to say. Times are getting dark, people. I want to pray more, amen. I want to read more, amen. I want to hear the voice of the Father more, amen. Because there is a time coming. Have you read any of the laws that Congress is trying to pass? My goodness, talk about freedoms being on the line. I really do believe, I don't prophesy anything. I'm not saying that, but I really do believe this year is going to determine a lot of things in the direction and the destruction of the U.S. I really do. So we need to pray more. We don't know what's going to happen. We don't. But I know there's a Father that will equip me with the tools I need to succeed. So we need to push further and harder to the things of God. Amen. Amen. So I'm going to be quiet now, but this has been a great service already. I really enjoyed the worship. What a beautiful presence of God. Don't leave here unchanged. If you leave here unchanged, it wasn't God, it was you. Amen. Amen.
Well, Shabbat Shalom, everyone, on this cold, semi-snowy day. I think it is supposed to get above freezing if it's not already, so yay. It's exciting, right? I think the main roads were pretty good for the most part. At least for the two-mile drive we drove. I do want to mention that please pray for Sister Korn. She wasn't feeling the best this morning, as well as Renee and the kids. There's some stuff that they're dealing with, so please keep them in prayer. For everybody we don't see, I don't know if that's because of the weather or otherwise, but the Carlsons, Charity, Carol, she told me last night if it was snowing, her car would not make it, so... anybody else that I can't think of right off the top of my head, just keep them in prayer. Young, I believe, will be back next weekend. I'm not sure if he's actually back in the States yet, but he is. Okay, he's probably recovering. Being wherever, Thailand, I think is where he was. Beautiful pictures. You'll have to ask him to show you. Beautiful. And I also want to mention to still pray for Amy's parents. I believe they are still doing better, correct? Yes, they are doing better, but they still need lots of prayer. So just mentioning that. And before I get everything else going, if we could go ahead and have the ushers come down and we'll take our tithe and offering. You can always give via cash or a check. If you do write a check, please make it out to the Ark or the Revival Center. You can give digitally through Cash App at @ArkPeru or PayPal at www.paypal.com/paypalme/ArkPeru. Both of those are very secure ways of giving. We get it immediately, and they can be found on our website as well at www.revivalcenterperu.com. So we'll go to the Lord in prayer before we start taking up tithes and offerings. Lord, we thank you for the opportunity to give. We thank you for the opportunity to be in your house, the freedom to be in your house and to worship you. So many things that we take for granted, God, and we thank you. We ask that you'd bless this tithe and offering to your kingdom. Let it be shaken down, pressed down, and running over. In the name of Jesus Christ, we ask and pray. Amen. And I want to say thank you to all the faithful givers that we have every week, day in or week in, week out. Thank you, thank you. And even if you're not able to, we love you just the same. I just want to mention that. And with all of that, we know tax season is upon us. So I will be getting the giving statements ready for those of you that write your name on the envelopes and let me know that it's you. So you can use that towards your tax deductions, okay? I can also email them if you'd prefer that. So I know that we have some live streamers that actually that give as well. So I'll be getting with you on that if I don't have an address. I do want to mention we have a mandatory children's ministry meeting on January 20th. So that, I believe, is 2 weeks from today. It's on a Saturday at 9:30 a.m. Please get with Bobby for any questions on that, okay? January 20th at 9:30, if you are back in the children's ministry in any capacity, that's helpers, that's main teachers, youth leaders, all of that, you must be here, okay? I mentioned last week that Amy had contacted us about starting to sing at local nursing homes. I believe she is still working on that, to my knowledge. And if you have any questions or concerns or you would like to be involved in that, please get in touch with her. I don't believe she's got social media right now, okay? So you have to text or call her. Everybody understand that? Okay. Amen. And we are starting our meetings again, our monthly men's and monthly ladies. Monthly men's meeting is next week, next Sunday, January 14th at 9:30 a.m., there's going to be, is it prayer first? Okay, prayer first here, and then they're going out to eat somewhere, wherever y'all determine. And then there's going to be some minor things to be worked on here at the building. If you're available to do that, that would be amazing. Ladies' meeting is going to be the following weekend, following Sunday, which is January 21st, at IHOP in Kokomo. So, yes. We are meeting at 11 a.m. at IHOP. If you need a ride, I know a couple of you have already told us that you need a ride. We've got you on the list for that. But if anybody else needs a ride, please let us know because we do base our times on when we leave our home based on that and who will be picking you up based on routes. Okay? But it's going to be a great time. And then Bobby is starting the women's Bible study at the boardwalk that will not be here at the church. Yay, amen. It's going to be awesome. I'm looking forward to it. It's going to be at the boardwalk right over here, like literally 10 steps that way. No, it's a little bit more, but it's right down here. And so that's going to be on January 28th, which is a Sunday, at 3 p.m. So a lot of our Sundays are taken up. We have second Sunday with men's meeting, third Sunday with ladies' meeting, fourth Sunday with a ladies' Bible study. Man, you got to catch up. You know, that just means the men can be home and babysit, right? I say babysit. It's their kids, too. It's not really babysitting. Just trying to be fun. Some of you laugh. Some of you don't. Think I'm weird. That's okay. It's all right. We're still having our Monday night prayer meetings from 6:30 to 8:00. That's still going on. Come in as you please and go as you please. Wednesday night Bible study with Brother Dan Winters. Food is provided at that one. Starts about 6:30, goes to about 8:15. So please come. You don't have to necessarily let them know you're coming. However, if they have a large influx of people, you might only get one chicken wing, okay? That'd be awesome though, right? Amen? That's a good problem to have. So next venture is youth announcements. So this is strictly for 12 to 18-year-olds. If you are back in the back with Brother and Sister McClay, they will have their youth Bible study, which they recently started a few months ago. I think it was September. That's going to be on January 13th. So that's next Saturday at 6 p.m. So have your child bring enough money to pick up fast food. So they will be going to some fast food joint and actually doing the Bible study there. So I feel like that's pretty cool, right? Witnessing in a different way. Amen. So if your child eats $20 worth of fast food, please give them that. Or whatever you deem necessary. Yeah, whatever you deem necessary. If you truly cannot afford that, then please, as always, talk to Brother and Sister McClay. Next exciting thing for youth is Winter Jam. That is coming up, yes, and just at a month's time frame. That is February 3rd on Saturday. The actual Winter Jam itself, concert, whatever you want to call it, starts at 6 p.m. in Indianapolis at the Gamebridge Fieldhouse. Okay, but they are meeting here at the church at 3:30 p.m. If you're late, I can't guarantee they'll wait on you, all right? They probably will, but that'll be up to them. You have to leave in enough time to get there, and you never know what the weather's doing as well, okay? So with that, if your youth is going, they need $15 just to get in. That's the entrance fee, and then money for food after. I think there's a Taco Bell they typically swing by, and I think that's the only thing open. So if you cannot afford the ticket or food afterwards, as always, please get with Brother or Sister McClay. But they must know by January 27th, okay, which is a week prior. So if you can't afford that, you have a few weeks to try to put back for that. But if you truly cannot, please get with them by January 27th. All youth and parents understand? Amen. And as always with that, parents, the waivers will need to be signed before your child will be allowed to go. And then the next youth Bible study after this month is going to be February 17th. Normally it would be the second Saturday, I believe, but to give a little break between the Winter Jam and the Bible study, it's going to be a week different. So location and food is to be determined on that one, but I just wanted to mention that. And as a reminder, we do have the Sam's class today. It is the first weekend in January. I know that's not the Hebrew calendar New Year, but it is our Gregorian calendar New Year. So I hope you've had a happy and blessed first week or first almost week of January, and then it continues to get better. Amen? We can only get, if you've had, you know, a sorry week, it can only go up from here. Amen? All right, so I'll go ahead and release the kids. Do we have nursery today? Okay, nursery, 0 to 2. Y'all can go ahead and get to your class, or 1 to 2. And then our children's class, 3 to 7-year-olds. Y'all can go ahead and make your way to the back. As well as the 8 to 11-year-olds. We are having youth class today as well. So youth class can be released also, and then Sam's class as well. And if y'all will please welcome Brother King as he comes.
Well, praise the Lord. So good to see you all this morning. And we're getting so spiritual, the chairs are flying around in here. It's all right. Be careful as you go to your classes, and quietly. Isn't it good to be in the kingdom of the Lord in 2024? Amen. Amen. How many of y'all watched last night's live stream? So, since the majority were not here and did not watch last night's live stream, that means I should speak it again. Amen. Sometimes the Lord does that. Just turn my mic up a little bit, please, so I don't have to push my voice so much, and I can just let the mic do the work. Thank you so much. But we were speaking of a really good topic last night, and we hadn't had a kingdom conversation in, I don't know, over a month. And I got some good feedback from that. And the truth of the matter is it's where a lot of people are at right now. So watch last night's live stream and watch it with an open mind, with an open heart, and allow God to hit those areas we spoke of. And see what the Lord will do in your life. Once again, it's so good to be in the presence of the Lord and to be with the people of God this morning. I know that wintertime can provide that good old feeling of drabness. Some even get, I don't know how they get it, but it's a condition of the mind. Seasonal depression, you know, the lack of sunlight contributes to the lower levels of vitamin D that's produced in your body, and then people feel down, and they love the sunshine, but then they complain when it gets to be 100 degrees or 90 degrees or 85 degrees, and they want to stay inside in the air conditioning. Let's make up our minds. What do we want? We want cold? Do we want hot? Windows open? Windows down? What? Or windows up? Anyway, don't let the season of winter freeze over your life. The winter season is the preparation for the spring season. And the spring is on the way. And we have four seasons here where we live. And the flowers will come back. The grass will turn green again. But winter has its purpose. So don't allow the season of winter just to get you down, get you depressed and drab. You can be full of the joy of the Lord, full of the presence of God, and still be in the winter season. In Jesus' name, amen. We are delighted to be here. So delighted. We had a powerful time of worship this morning. And did you feel what I felt? I didn't tell you what I felt, but maybe if you say I did, then that means you felt something too. Now, God is more than a feeling, but His presence was here. He was touching lives, and I was over in this area right over here, and I discerned, and I could just feel there's an angel of mercy ministering to people. And sad thing is, sometimes even the mercy of God can't reach somebody. Even the mercy of God is not enough for someone to allow their heart to be softened. But the angel of the Lord's mercy, because He works through His Spirit, sends forth His ministers, they work on our behalf if we're doing the work of the kingdom. And was over there ministering to people and touching lives. And we have to remember we cannot live without the mercy of God. You cannot live without the mercy or the grace of God. If you didn't do anything to earn it, you couldn't pay for it, and nothing you could conjure up or arrange or bring to yourself could ever do what the mercy and grace of God has done in your life and my life. And I love it when Jeremiah says, His mercies are new every morning. Great is His faithfulness. His compassions, they fail not. So as we go along in our lives, a lot of times I'll be praying and I'll pray for a specific situation, or I'll be praying for the people of God. Even in our worship services, I'm praying for y'all sometimes. And I'll just cry out to the Lord, Jesus, Son of the Most High God, have mercy on your people. Because I know my frame and theirs, and we are but dust. Totally undeserving, without God, until God breathed into our lives. And we need to always remember that. Always remember that. That'll change how you approach His presence, change how you react when you worship the Lord, when we're singing together. I'm not preaching to you. I'm just talking to the sheep, talking to the people of the Lord. That'll change your whole demeanor. You remember, without Him, you're lost. Without Him, you don't come into His sheepfold. Without Him, you can't find the door. Without Him, you can't even breathe. Without Him, death is on your doorstep. And you, the soul that sins, it shall surely die according to the law of God. That doesn't change. But God. And I love this passage in Ephesians. I believe it's chapter 1 or 3. Forgive me if I don't remember the reference. But God, who is rich in mercy, for His great love, wherewith He loved us, even when we were dead in trespasses and sins, made us alive. Amen. Amen. Well, let's get into the Word of the Lord again. Just wanted to share those things with you and remind you, God's not finished, and He's way ahead of the place you think He's at. He's way ahead of us. He hasn't lost anything, and He hasn't forgotten anything, and He hasn't forgotten any person, and He knows the injustices that are in the world. He knows the lying, the deception going on at the levels of government. He knows that. You don't have to be deceived. Let's get into the Word of God. I'm going to get back into the Word we focused on last night, and I just felt I couldn't get away from this subject. Felt like the people of the Lord needed to hear this. I know some of you weren't here, but we're going to start just for chronological order. I'm going to start in Isaiah 41 today because that's the Old Testament. And then I'm going to tie in Matthew chapter 12, verses 43 through 45. Isaiah 41, let me get to my place in Matthew. Isaiah 41, I will open rivers in the high places, fountains in the midst of the valleys. I will make the wilderness a pool of water and the dry land springs of water. Did he say, I feel like I'm going to do this? Is there a question mark there? If anyone has the right to say, I will and it shall be done, it's God Himself. So He promises to open rivers in the high places, fountains in the middle of the valleys, wildernesses to make pools of water, and dry land will spring forth with water. That's the promise of God. Now jump over into Matthew chapter 12. We're looking at verses 43 through 45. When the unclean spirit is gone out of a man, he walks through what? Dry places, seeking rest and finding none. Then he says, I will return into my house from whence I came out. Notice, he says it's my house. He laid claim to something he didn't create. This is so powerful. And when he has come, he finds it empty, swept, and garnished. He goes and takes with him seven other spirits, more wicked than himself. And they enter in and dwell there, and the last state of that man is worse than the first. Even so shall it be also unto this wicked generation. Father of mercies, we cry out to you. Let your will be done. Let your kingdom come. That mighty signs and wonders, salvations and baptisms, and people being brought to repentance will be done in the mighty name that is above every name, the Lord Jesus Christ, full of grace, full of truth. Amen. Amen. Walking through dry places. We look at our text. I'm going to do a little teaching and both preaching, so just hold right on there. We'll get somewhere with this. In our text, we are looking at a human life in Matthew chapter 12, full of potential, full of the grace of God, full of the mercy of God, a human life that God has come in. And if you watched last night, you know what I said happened. God has come in and cleaned house. God came in and arranged the furniture. God came in and put up the drapes. God came in and put a new dining room table in there and put a new memory foam mattress in the bedroom and a new bed. Cleaned up the bathroom, put some flooring down, and see, that's what I want done in my house. So I'm preaching, but I'm projecting. And I'm believing. Amen. God came in and cleaned house. God never leaves a person the same way he finds them. Say, well, I thought I was good in myself. You are good because God created you in himself, for himself, and through his word, and shaped you and formed you. But without God, you lack purpose. You lack life. And it's meaningless. You eat, you drink, and you die without God in your life. And so Jesus is telling us a parable, and he's showing a life that God has come in and cleaned house. In fact, the scripture implies that he has kicked out unwelcome occupiers, kicked out squatters. Squatters who, in this passage, have claimed this to be their house. I'll tell you, their devils don't tell the truth. They don't tell you the truth because they're claiming the house that God has built, the house that God has cleaned, the house that God has furnished, the house that God has put things in order in, that it's theirs. It's why they're wicked. They don't do the things of God, so don't get involved with them. Iniquity, lawlessness, going against the law of God, claiming something that they have no right to. Because of the price Jesus Christ paid for your sin and my sin and your life and my life, he has no right to my house. The enemy has no right to my house. I want you to say that. I want you to repeat that. Just repeat this. Jesus Christ paid the price for my life, and the enemy has no right in my house. You are projecting into your atmosphere. Just because he wants to lie and tell you you messed up, you let things get out of order, doesn't make it his house. But that also doesn't mean he can't come in and tear some things up if you allow it. And so in this passage, we're looking at a man or a woman. Jesus says a man that had an unclean spirit. Life was a wreck. He stank. Stank, stunk. Stink, stank, stunk. The mean one came in and made it stink, stank, stunk. I still remember that as a kid.
Stink, stank, stunk.
That's what the devil does in your life. He stinks it up. You walk around carrying odors that smell of evil. Everything stinks. And Jesus comes in and cleans your house, cleans your life, and this is what we're looking at. However, though God has done a complete work in our lives, there are still things that we will encounter as we walk along that need to be addressed. I could tell you that when I received the baptism of the Holy Spirit, my mind changed. My vision changed. My conscience changed. Everything changed. But just because everything changed doesn't mean I had everything figured out. And it does not mean that I didn't have to encounter some things as I walked along in my life with the Spirit of God that needed changed themselves. There are just some things that you have to give up, and God will give you the strength for it, but He leaves the power in your hands to do so. You know, you can be delivered and I can be delivered, but if I'm never healed after I'm delivered, then there's a good chance I'm going to go back into the bondage that I was in before. So with the deliverance comes a healing. This is the exact condition of the man in Jesus' parable. He was delivered. The unclean spirit had gone out and God had fixed the house, but he was not healed. You say, why wasn't he healed? He wasn't healed because if a healed person and a delivered person is living in a place that has God in it, no devil wants to go there. No devil is going to waste his time trying to defeat a God he knows he cannot overcome. So if God is living in your house, no devil can enter your house. But though this person was delivered, much like many in the church today and in our world today, outside of the church, he was never healed. So how do you know that? He had some dry places. The scripture goes on to say, when the unclean spirit went out, he looked for other dry places. Looking for a place to recreate. Now the word in the King James Version is rest, and that's the Greek word anapausis, which can imply a resting or a recreation. Use this example. What do you think is motivating a person who just wants to play around in the presence of God? The unclean spirit had gone out. God had cleaned the house. His presence never left the world. But there were some things that were unhealed in the house. When you have a mind in the presence of an almighty God to play around when the Spirit is moving and when lives are being touched, a devil is recreating in your thoughts. That's what's motivating you. That's what's influencing you. A devil is recreating in your thoughts. And this is what the unclean spirit did. He went out looking for a place to play. A dry place. Because the dry places are where he's most suitable and that are most comfortable for him. This is why the promise was given before the New Testament was written in the book of Isaiah that I would make springs in the desert. And this is why when Jesus came on the scene and he spoke many words. One of the things he spoke to the woman at the well. He said, if I give you this water, and you drink it, it will be inside of you a well springing up into everlasting life. He said it and he meant it, and he didn't hold back and say, well, it might happen or it should happen. No, he said, if I give you this water, this is what it's going to do. I'm going to make you a well, not a dry place. No one likes a dry well. You can't survive long if you don't have water. And I can't survive long if I don't have water. Brother Korn gave us some statistics last night. And he was talking about the parts of our body that are mainly comprised of water. I think the earth is something like 80% water, and your bodies in total are about over 80% water. You need water to live, and this is what Jesus promised to do in the Scriptures. And this is what God, through Jesus, promised to do, and His prophetic word is true. Isaiah 41 and 18, He will make springs in the desert. Rivers in the high places. Fountains in the middle of the valleys, or wilderness, a pool of water, and the dry land, springs of water. Going back to the parable that Jesus gave us in Matthew chapter 12, this wonderful teaching about an unclean spirit and a man being delivered, does that anywhere imply that a devil likes to have it go to a place where there's water? I know it's a rhetorical question, but you can answer that honestly. The devils go out of the man. They're seeking for the dry places. They're looking for the places that are hard, that are dry, that don't have water in the ground, that aren't fruitful. This is what happens. But God has to heal the ground of your heart. If the ground of your heart's not sealed and healed, He can't put the seed in it, and it can't water it and bring life out of it. So you can be delivered and not healed, and your life will be in the same state because you never finished the process. A lot of people come to church, they never finish the process, and so the work of God seems incomplete in their life because they didn't let God heal the areas that were dry and hardened in their hearts. It's what I call these dry places. They're areas where the soil has been hardened due to a lack of water, where the heart is hardened, and they've been left alone. But the promise Jesus gave was that it will be a well springing up into you and out of you into everlasting life. And in John 16, Jesus is visiting Jerusalem during the Feast of Tabernacles, and He says, "Come unto me and drink. If you're thirsty, come to me." Pull that up, John chapter 7. John chapter 7. John chapter 7. It's about the middle of the feast. Jesus shows up on the scene. Here we go. Verse 37. "In the last day, that great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried, saying, If any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink. He that believes on me, as the scripture has said, out of his belly will flow rivers of living water." If living water is flowing out of your belly, is there a dry place in there? God's will is for you to have water in your desert. Springs in your high places and pools of water in the wildernesses that you go through. It's a promise. Two times we've read that Jesus promised to give water to the thirsty. He prophesied of Himself in Isaiah 41 to make a spring in the desert. And our text in Matthew 12 says the devils, when they go out of a man, go looking for those places the water has not touched.
What are you getting at, Pastor King? I'm saying there's areas in our lives that we haven't surrendered to God, and they're dry places, and until the river touches them, they'll never bear fruit, and there'll always be a place where the devil can play. You say, but I've given my life to God. But you got dry places. And until the water touches them, they'll continue to be hard. They'll continue to crack in the sun, and they won't be fruitful. Men, women, and all the empires and civilizations who have ever inhabited the face of this planet have always built cities around rivers. Cities by the sea. Water attracts people. Think about it. Some of the five of the largest cities in the United States of America are built on water. More than that, Seattle's on the water, San Francisco's on the water, LA is on the water, San Diego's on the water. Miami's on the water. Boston is on the water. New York is on the water. People are attracted to water for a reason. Because it's part of your being, and it's the will of God for your life so that He can put a river of life in you and take those dry places and make them fruitful. God desired to grow a garden inside of you that would glorify Him and would be a place where you could rest. But if you have a dry place, the place you should be resting is a place where a devil can recreate. It's an area that you haven't allowed Him to touch. I want you to take some self-inventory. In 2023, are there areas in my life that I haven't allowed God's water and His river and His life to touch me that I'm afraid of letting go of? I think if we were to answer that honestly, we would all say, yes, there's areas in our lives that I have not allowed or you have not allowed God to enter, and it's become a dry place. And God's desire is to make that a fruitful place. God's desire is to take the pain that was there and make a promise come forth. And God's desire is to take the loss that was there and give you gain in Him and restore the years that were lost. It was brought up last night that when Jesus gave the command to the disciples, He said, let's go to the other side of the lake. And on the other side of the lake were two men who lived in the tombs full of devils. And if you remember the story, they begged Jesus not to send them into the deep. See, they found plenty of areas to recreate and lives to trash and lives to torment and people to destroy in dry places. That's why the man and the other man were cutting themselves, running around naked. They couldn't be bound by any chains. No medicine of the day could help them. No doctor could figure out what was going on. Jesus comes along. He recognizes the issue for what it is. It's not mental illness. It's a devil recreating in a life that I created, and He sent those devils into the swine. But the devils even beg, don't send us to the deep. Because anywhere the river flows, there's life, and anywhere a devil recreates, he's bringing death. That should make us think about our weaknesses and the things we give into when we feel tempted. And you know, we've all been there. You feel tempted. Well, maybe if I just give in just a little bit. God's trying to heal that place. God's trying to reveal your weakness to you so He can put His strength through you. And you're going to let the devil walk all over you. You're letting him recreate in a place that God wants to put the water in that's dry. an unsurrendered place in your heart. It's a dry place. Jesus promised to fill these. David writes in Psalm chapter 23, "The Lord is my shepherd, and I shall not want, because He's my shepherd. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for His name's sake. And yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil." And it goes on. "But He leads you beside still waters and in green pastures." What makes a pasture green? It's the water! If your grass doesn't have access to water, it's going to be brown, dried out, and its roots are not going to stick in the soil. But if the grass of your house has a good supply of water, it's going to be a vibrant green. At least most grass is. You know those, you ever seen those people that they make a living out of keeping their lawn green? Always watering the lawn, because the green in the lawn, the life in the grass, and the nourishment from the water that the trees receive all comes because of the access to the water. And death cannot abide where life is. The power of life is given through God, and He overcame death, so death would no longer have power over you. And if you have life in you, and you have water in you, God is going to create a green pasture and still waters for you to live by and dwell in. And that's His will for these dry places in our lives. He wants to break up that ground, make a spring go through there so that it can hold seed and produce a crop and be fruitful. It's an area, maybe it was something destroyed in your life. Maybe it was a relationship that completely overwhelmed your emotional cup and your ability to compensate for the trauma and the damage. God wants to touch it, bring water there, bring life there, put seed in it, and make it a green pasture and a testimony to His glory and a place for you to rest. See, if you don't allow the Lord to touch that area of your life, it's going to be a place for the devils to recreate instead of a place where you can rest. I know. I've been there. God's desire is to produce fruit out of what was a negative result or a negative event. Or a destructive event in your and my lives. When it's dry and there's no water, it can't produce fruit. When it's dry and it lacks water, it can't produce fruit. If a land is experiencing a drought, a famine is sure to follow. You know, we read the story in the book of 1 Kings where Elijah prayed and it did not rain for 3 years and 6 months. 3 years and 6 months without rain in a semi-arid climate is going to bring a famine. And so if you don't have the water flowing into these places that God desires to make fruitful, it's going to bring a famine in your life. There'll be no fruit there. That'll continue to be a place where an enemy can come and dance on your grave, or the grave of what could have been, what should have been, and what would have been. But the Lord doesn't want that to be the result in your life. The Lord wants to take that place, make it fruitful, and say what is and what is to come is greater than what was, and any of the dryness that was there prior to the water flowing through it. He wants to make your end greater than your beginning. Restore the years that were stolen. John chapter 16, verses 7 through 13 speaks of the Spirit of truth and the Comforter. Verse 13, howbeit when He, the Spirit of truth, is come, He will guide you into all truth, for He shall not speak of Himself, but whatever He shall hear, that shall He speak. We are commanded in the Scripture to be swift to hear, slow to speak, and slow to wrath. I think Jesus had it right, because He heard the Father, and He spoke and did what the Father said do. Right? He heard the Father. He saw what the Father did. Jesus spoke the Father's words and did the Father's deeds. So when the Spirit of truth has come in your life, the same Spirit that Jesus had in His life as a man, He's going to tell you things He hears from the Father and expects you to walk with Him and obey. And what happens is God comes into your life. He starts cleaning things up. He sets your drapes in order. He puts your furniture in order. He fixes your flooring, fixes the bathroom, puts food in the refrigerator, gives you a deep freezer full of venison. Wants to grow a beautiful, fruitful garden. And that's the beginning of the process. God's concerned about your individual house, but the land is His as well, and He wants to not only stop there. And here's what happens through the Spirit of truth. He begins to guide you and take you to the places, and you begin to confront some things, or you should confront some things that have been dry places that God wants to heal. And we have to be able to allow God to confront some things in our lives if we're ever to be healed. You say, well, I got the Holy Ghost. He cleaned my house. But what does your yard look like? Who's occupying your house? Is your water supply stopped up? Earlier on in this passage of John chapter 16, it says, because I've said these things unto you, this is verse 6, we're looking at verse 6 through 11. Because I've said these things unto you, sorrows filled your heart. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth, it is expedient for you that I go away, for if I go not away, the Comforter will not come unto you. But if I depart, I will send Him unto you, and when He has come, He will reprove or convince the world of sin. And of righteousness and of judgment, of sin because they believe not on Me, of righteousness because I go to My Father and you see Me no more, of judgment because the prince of this world is judged. We have to be willing as people of God to say, God, don't only clean my house, take me through the Spirit of truth, lead me to those places that are dry, and You confront the things in my life that need reproof, and I'm willing to go through that with You. Because if He leaves them alone, they attract devils. If He leaves them alone, they'll never be fruitful. If He leaves them alone, there's no green pasture. There's not a still water. And it becomes a dry place that hardens in your life. And many hearts have been hardened. And that's all they are, is dry places. It's not that God can't touch them. It's not that the soil doesn't have the elements and the minerals needed to sustain life. It's that there's no water. And so they're hardened and they're dry. And devils are jumping up and down on those graves. You want a devil to inhabit your life? Harden your heart. You'll destroy yourself. I speak to the trauma in people's dry places today. And I speak that the water of life is coming to those dry places right now. Come on, everyone, lift up your hands. I want you to... I know I'm not jumping off the chandeliers. I'm kind of teaching. I'm kind of preaching. And I'm not swinging on the ceiling fans. Lift up your hands. I speak to those dry places in the people today. Lord, I ask that your water of life will flow freely in them. God, that you'll convince those of righteousness. That's the promise. You promised, Lord. You promised to let the water of life come out of their bellies. You promised that it would be a well springing up into them unto everlasting life, not a habitation of devils. Lord, identify those places today and heal your people's hearts in the name of Jesus Christ. In the name of Jesus Christ. Going back to our passage in Matthew chapter 12. I don't have a whole lot more to say. Going back to our passage in Matthew chapter 12. The unclean spirit went out of the person. They were delivered. Went out to the yard. Looking for another place to build a house. Remember, he said, I will return to my house. You'll pay attention to the language here. The words use the word picture. It's as if God built a house and furnished it, but somehow a devil got access and started building a house from the inside. So God gave you and I a place to freely inhabit, to live, to breathe, to raise our families, to experience our successes, a place to worship, a place to pray, a place to cohabitate with God. And it's as if the person in the parable kicked God out and said, you know what? Thank you for cleaning up my house, but God, I'll take it from here. So what happens is the enemy begins to build houses on the inside of the structure. And so the outside wall is no longer the outside wall because now there's an inside wall and there's a structure being built within, and pretty soon the ceiling's gone, the wall over here is gone, the wall over here is gone. This is not the true front door. This is not the roof, because an enemy says, that was a place I had the pleasure and I had access to it and it suited me. I want my house, as a man of God, as a person that God has created, not only as a pastor, as a husband, as a father, but as a man, to not be a house that any devil feels comfort in. And I think some of us, we've become so comfortable. Some people have become so comfortable with their demons, they bring them to church, and that's why you walk out unchanged, not delivered, and nothing ever really happens in your life, and you don't get anything out of church. Because God built you a house and gave you the furnishings, but you let a devil get comfortable in there and start building one on the inside. And so the devil goes to the yard. He looks for a place suitable. It's an area that God has not yet touched, that we have not yet fully surrendered, and that is a place of His liking. I didn't find any there. No, the river's reaching all the way out there as well. He says, I'm going to go back to the place that I built within the house that God built, and I'm going to see if I'm welcome there. And what does the scripture imply? It implies he goes back and finds a place suitable for him and his buddies to live. Why is that? If God's there, it's not a dry place. If God's not there, it becomes the house, the whole house. Because the area that wasn't dealt with, the whole house has now become a dry place, and the devil has found a suitable habitation, and now he brings his buddies, and they build a stronghold there. And the last state of that man is worse than the first. All because you, or the person this parable is referring to, apply this to your life. I'm going to apply it to my life. Won't allow God to reach some areas. When he can't reach some areas, the enemy puts a flag down and a stake in the ground and says, this is mine. I'm going to start building from here. It is time for the church of the living God, especially this church and the one in America, that we wake up and we need to recognize and identify the dry places in our lives, or we'll keep making the same mistakes, keep having the same thoughts, keep having the same defeats, and keep not losing out on victory that God has already promised. We don't let Him touch those areas that are sensitive to us. Say, Lord, just clean the house, but the soil outside is going to be dry. God doesn't clean up your soil. If He doesn't heal your land, the house is soon to follow. I don't want any enemy that hates my life having any access or comfort in my house. That's why the writer, the apostle, 1 John, says, all that is in the world, the lust of the eye, the lust of the flesh, and the pride of life is not of God, but it's of the world. You say, well, God didn't create the flesh. God created the flesh, but the flesh wars against the spirit, and the spirit has to have dominion so your house can be cleaned and your ground can be healed. But if you allow the lust of the eye, the lust of the flesh, and the pride of life to have any foothold in your life, your whole house will be taken over. He'll have the yard, the bedroom, the kitchen, every relationship, get your blessing. You don't allow the Lord to become the Lord of the place that was dry. He can't be Lord at all in your life. The one eloquent man of God said, if He's not Lord of all, He's not Lord at all. So these areas of my heart that I hold back, sensitive areas, loss, trauma, pain associated with defeat, failed expectations, abuse, they're dry places in lives that God wants to bring the water of life to and heal them. Ezekiel gives a prophecy. I believe it's chapter 37. Everywhere the river flowed, there was life in a great many number of trees along the banks, and there were fish in the river. Everywhere the current of God flows, there's still life. Everywhere that God touches, He still brings springs of life. Every desert can be made fruitful if we'll just give the river access to our dry places. Every single one of them, even the ones you're afraid of and you're ashamed of. Lord, be the Lord in the places that are currently dry in my life. God, heal and reveal by your Spirit and reprove the things in me that I've allowed to become dry places. And may I always be willing and obedient to be reproved. Send out your judgments, Lord, for they are true and righteous altogether. And make this dry valley full of bones, a fruitful place and a mighty army. Y'all could stand across the building. Lord, as we stand together in your word and your presence in your life today, God, this valley of life and all of its circumstances, all of its defeats, all of its fears, all of the darkness, make this valley and these bones live. Bring water to the desert. Bring streams out of the rock. Bring the high places down and exalt the valleys. And let your water and your river flow. And each and every one of your people today, touch their hearts and their lives. And make them quick to obey your word. Touch those places of shame. Touch those places that were degraded and seemingly destroyed. Touch those places where fear has reigned instead of love. Touch those places with your water, where the darkness has enshrouded the people and their vision is not plain and clear. Touch those places with the water of life. Make them fruitful. Take the dryness away. Take the hardness away. Break it up by the Spirit of the name of the Lord, our God, and His authority in me today. Touch them now. Speak deliverance and speak healing. Speak hope and speak wholeness. Speak health and wellness. Speak life. If any man thirst, let him come to me and drink. This spake he of the Spirit. In a wilderness and a dry and thirsty land, let your people drink. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, the name above all names, amen. Amen. Walking through the dry places in your life. Confronting the uncomfortable places in your heart. Finding the stream that will be the source of life to bring forth the green grass, the pretty flowers, the fruitful trees in the barren, dry place, that God will transform and you will be laid beside the still waters and you'll rest. And the place where the devils recreated, you will rest, says the Lord.
but only if you give me access to those areas. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Praise God. Lift up your hands and thank Him. Is any sick among you? Let him call for the elders of the church. Let them pray over him and anoint him with oil. Lay hands on them and God will heal them. Is any hungry for a salvation experience? Is any thirsty for the water of life? Does anyone wish to repent? You can do so right now. Now is the day of salvation. Now is the day of the time. God is calling you. You weren't here by accident. You didn't come through the door because you felt like it. You came through, and I'm not preaching. I'm inviting you. You came through because God loves you, and He wants to take those areas in your life and heal them and bring fruit and life through them. It's not only for you, it's through your generations. It's not only for you, it's for your children. It's not only for you now, it's for the church. And your purpose in life.
you.